Arrays are a common data type in Java and part of the SQL 99 standard, so it should be easy and quite common to use them with Hibernate, right? No, they aren't. Most developers try to avoid using arrays in their persistence layers. There are several reasons for that. Not all DBMS support arrays, because of that, Hibernate doesn't support native database array type. Mappings as an element collection are not very efficient. Most developers prefer to model a many-to-many or one-to-many association. And Hibernate can't offer lazy loading for the elements of an array. That makes it a bad data type for any associations. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen, and in this video I will show you how to use an array as a data type with Hibernate and the different pitfalls you should avoid. If you are new to this channel and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredibly efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring, and all types of other Java persistence-related stuff, subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video, that helps me to reach a broader audience. I explained element collection in a previous video, which you will find in the description, so I keep this part short. The elements of an element collection get mapped to a separate database table, but they don't have a separate lifecycle and identity. They are part of the entity itself. That makes them easy to use, but it also forces Hibernate to always read and write the element collection together with all other attributes. This often creates performance issues. Let's take a look at an example of a book entity. Each book belongs to one or more topics. The names of these topics are modeled as an element collection of type string array. In the table model, the topic names get persisted in the book underscore topics table. Whenever you fetch a book entity from the database, Hibernate will need to execute an additional query to get the elements of the string array topics attributes. And if you change any attribute of a book entity, Hibernate will remove all of its records from the book topics table and insert a new record for each element in the topics attribute. Another mapping you should avoid is the mapping as a too-many association as an array. The main reason for that is that Hibernate doesn't support lazy loading for it. Because an array has a fixed size, Hibernate has to initialize the association when it instantiates the entity object. That often causes lots of unnecessary database queries and slows down your application. When mapping the association as a java.util.List or java.util.Set, you can use fetch type lazy to tell Hibernate not to fetch the association until you use it in your business code. This almost always provides the best performance and avoids N+1 select issues. Okay, let's take a look at one of the two ways you can efficiently use an array in your mapping. By default, Hibernate maps a Java array of any type to a binary type in the database. This mapping works well if you only store and read the attribute in your business code. But it provides only minimal support for queries. Because the attribute is mapped as a binary type, you can compare the full array that's stored in the database field with the value of a bind parameter. In the example of this video, a book on the topics Java persistence and Hibernate will only get returned by the query if I search for books with exactly these two topics. But if I try to select all books on the topic Hibernate, the query doesn't return any books on multiple topics, even though one of them is Hibernate. That makes the mapping as a binary type a bad fit for most applications. I said at the beginning of this video that Hibernate can't map a Java array as a native database array, but you might want to use it anyways, because in contrast to the mapping as a binary type, you can search within a database array. You then need to provide a custom user type implementation and reference this type in your entity mapping. The user type interface might look intimidating because it requires you to implement several methods. But for the typical array types, this isn't too complex. The most important methods are SQL types, return class, nullsafe get, and nullsafe set. The first two methods return the SQL and the Java type supported by this user type implementation. The nullsafe set method sets your Java array as a native database array on the prepared statement. When you implement this method, you have to call the setNull value on your prepared statement if the Java array is null. The nullsafeGet method gets a Java SQL array object from the result set and retrieves its values as a Java array. Please keep in mind that the database column might contain no value. In that case, the Java SQL array is null and you need to handle it accordingly. After you implemented your user type, you need to reference it in your entity mapping. You can do that by annotating your entity attribute with Hibernate's type annotation and setting the fully qualified class name as the value of its type attribute. The main benefit of mapping your attribute to a native database array is its additional query capabilities. Using PostgreSQL and a native SQL query, you can use the any function in your where clause to retrieve all records containing a specific value as one of the array elements. So the following query returns all book entities which have the value Hibernate as one of the values in the string array topics attribute. If you want to use a Java array in your domain model, you can choose between the mapping as a binary type and a native database array. I prefer mapping it as a native database array because it allows you to search within the array. Hibernate doesn't support this mapping out of the box. You need to provide a custom user type implementation that tells Hibernate how to handle the Java and the native database array. After you implemented your user type, you can use native SQL queries to search for specific values within your array. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free member library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content like cheat sheets and ebooks about JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!